your eyes on the screen as we sing our songs tonight. I love to tell the story. Amen. I love to tell the story. On the verse, sing.
I love to tell the story of unseen things above. Oh, Jesus and His glory. Oh, Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story because I know it is true. It satisfies my longing as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story. Story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and His love. Last verse now. I love to tell the story for those who know it best. Seem hungering and thirsty to hear it like the rest. And when in scenes of glory I sing the new, new song, 'twill be the old, old story that I have loved so long. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme.
Right before we sing the second song, I'd like to ask Pastor Sammy Fistine, the pastor of Faithway Bible Baptist Church in Liloan, Cebu in the north, to come and lead us in a word of opening prayer. While he comes, I'd like to ask those that will be presenting tonight, the missionaries will be presenting, please occupy these seats here in the front so you can be ready to just, we can save time of you getting out of your seat and coming up here. We can be quick about our presentations tonight, all right? Just occupy and stay in these front rows. Pastor Fistine, please lead us in a word of opening prayer.
Okay, let's bow our heads and close our eyes as we look to the prayer this time. Most gracious Heavenly Father, in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, we are so thankful, Lord, that you have allowed us to come.
Yes.
This mission conference once again to challenge us, yes, in the work of mission. Lord, what a blessing, Lord, for all the preaching that has already been done.
Yes,
and we pray for tonight, Lord, that you will once again speak to us in a very special way.
Yes,
and call more missionaries to the foreign land, Panginoon, yes, and help us to even involve ourselves and challenge ourselves, even our churches, to the work of mission, Lord.
Amen.
This is our responsibility. This is our goal. This is our plan, Panginoon, Lord, and your plan, Panginoon, na ang mission ay ito po ay magpatuloy na lumago, O Diyos.
Amen.
Bless the speakers tonight. All these things I pray on us in Jesus Christ's most precious name and for His sake alone. Amen and amen.
Amen. Welcome one another, please. Say good evening to as many as you can. Turn around and shake one another's hands. And then we will sing our second song, okay? We will sing our second song to the regions beyond. To those that are tuning in online, we welcome you all from different parts of the world, from Africa, from Europe, from the Americas, in the North and South America, in Canada, here in Asia. Thank you for tuning in, and may God bless us all. All of you that are tuning in from all over the Philippines, God bless you as well. To the regions beyond. Ready on the verse, sing.
To the regions beyond, I must go, where the story has never been told. To the millions that never have heard of His love, sweet story of old. To the regions beyond, I must go. Salvation shall know. To the hardest of places He calls me to go, never thinking of wrong for the rain. The world may pronounce me a dreamer of good, yet not keep the Master I please. To the regions beyond I must go. Now there are others lost that the Master must bring, and to them must the message be told. He sends me to gather them out of all land and welcome them back to His fold. To the regions beyond I must go.
Thank you. You may be seated. So far tonight, our registration desk has reported 1,050 registered delegates. Amen. Praise God. And we have 480 local pastors, including their wives, 67 missionaries to the foreign land, and then single missionary, 19. And then we have members attending from different churches, 268, and church workers from other parts as well, 223. So we praise the Lord for this number. I know many could not come. I was thinking that they could come because of the holiday, but I misinterpreted it because many of us use the holidays as an opportunity for us to do different schedules, conferences and camps. I know the Bukidnon folk are having a camp right now. Those that are in different parts of this island as well. But at any rate, we're so thankful to the Lord for all of you that are here today. And tonight, as our emphasis in this missions is all about the world, we would like to hear from our representatives that are going to different parts, representing us. And so here are our representatives going to, first up, our Creative Access Nations. Now, these are nations that are not really welcome to preach the gospel, but we have creative ways to be able to penetrate the gospel in that area. So please, those of you that are from the Cran area, please come right now. Lahat ng mga taga Cran, right now. Come to the front very quickly. And then state your name, where you come from, your church, and just a little view about your mission.
Wan Chang Hao.
Excuse me.
I am Hanalea Valera. I am from Bethany Baptist Church, Makati, under the leadership of our pastor, Pastor Jerry Noble, and I am going to a creative restricted access nation in East Asia. Due to its restriction, I cannot mention its name, but let me tell you about its about it and its need of more laborers. This country, I'm sure you have heard of it over the news, because this is the country that we have a rift against over the West Philippine Sea. This country has the most irreligious population all over the world. 91% of its population claims to be irreligious or without religion. And one, two, three survey says that in every 3 seconds, a person in this country dies. And it's just heartbreaking how how there is a very slim chance that the soul of this person is going to heaven. Churches, brethren, I don't have the luxury of time to tell you in details the great need of this country, but I just pray that the Lord of the Harvest would call or would touch hearts of a man or a woman or a family that would also be able to say, here am I am willing to go. Thank you so much, Pastor Gisalva and Bible Baptist Church, Katipunan.
Good evening, Church. My name is Melody Ann Loro. I'm your missionary, single lady missionary to Creative Restriction, Restricted Access Nation, which is Laos. I came from Bethany Baptist Church, Taguig, under Pastor Solon Roy Loro. Laos is a communist country. We cannot really freely share the gospel there. But the Lord broke my heart into missions and called me there. We need more missionaries there because we don't have much of the missionaries we need there. As a teacher, it's my vision to teach the children there and reach more souls there who are bound for hell, just like we were before we got saved. We were also bound for hell. So as I have received the salvation freely, I want to share it to the people there. So I'm asking for your prayers and support as I go the going, as I do the going and share the gospel there. I hope that we could be partners as we do the Lord's commission. Thank you so much, Church, and good evening.
Good evening. I am Ruth Ann Taco, your partner going to Myanmar. I will be partnering with Missionary Yolen in Ipido in Myanmar. As many of you know, Myanmar is under civil war and hectic situation, but I believe that the Lord has called me to that place, and my life is already placed in His hand. And I believe also that there is a person that needs to hear about the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And I am blessed and happy to represent you in the field of Myanmar. Please pray for me, and thank you so much for your prayers and support. And thank you, Pastor, for this opportunity. Thank you, and God bless.
Good evening po. I am Kaela Pedraza, and I'm from Bethany Baptist Church, Makati, under the leadership of Pastor Gerardo G. Nable. And I am going to the field of India, your missionary to the field of India. And let me share to you this po quickly. Can still remember the words that Pastor Altura mentioned, that mas matataba pa ang baka kaysa sa bata. Sorry po, kinakabahan po ako, at gusto ko lamang din po sabihin, nasa biyaya lamang po ng Panginoon kung bakit po ako naandito sa inyong harapan ngayon. Naalala ko po yung sinabi ni Pastor Altura na mas matataba pa ang baka, ang mga baka kaysa sa bata. And that burdens my heart to surrender my life to be a missionary in India. And I would like to thank you, Pastor Kent Gisalba. It was Pastor Kent whom God used why I surrendered my life. And I would like to encourage you din po, if this were to be our last day po, isipin po natin kung ito na pong huling araw natin, why not give our best to the Lord po and be faithful? Because we are not guarantee of our tomorrow po. And I do believe that a life totally committed to God has nothing to lose, nothing to fear, and nothing to regret po. Thank you so much po.
Wait, if you're telling us about yourself, go slow. Wamang kamogi gokod. Hello? Because we want to understand where you're going. If we are going to support you, we have to know what you are, who you are, and where you came from. And go slow because we cannot understand English. We only understand English at 3 o'clock in the morning. Amen? Thank you. I hope you understand. God bless you.
Thank you, Pastor, for this great privilege to present our testimony. My name is Ervijan Bindoy, and we are your missionary going to the field of India in the city of Noida. And we are from La Loma Baptist Church, my sending church, and my sending pastor is Pastor Ramil Ulalia. And the Bible says, faithful is he that calleth you, who will also do it. We know na hindi madali po ang pagtungo sa lugar ng India. But I believe with all of my heart that the gospel is not bound. These people will be saved once we present them the gospel. One Indian told me this when I went there. He reminded me this very great reminder. He told me, Missionary Irvi, please don't change your heart for India. After I see all the things in India, I received that great reminder. But what really breaks my heart, my friend, is the next statement. Please come back. That is really a burden to me. Knowing that one Indian is hoping that a missionary will go back. It is really a great burden to me. Please, ang pakiusap ko po sa inyo, tulungan niyo po kaming makabalik. Billions of people are hoping that the gospel will be presented. Thank you so much po.
Good evening everyone. I'm Brother Jonas Paz. I'm a former OFW in the Middle East and was called to go to the land of India. The place where they say it's the harvest is truly plenteous. Literally, it's India. 1.4 billion people. A good reason to partner with us and even help us there. No? I'm coming from Bethany Baptist Church, Makati. My sending pastor, Pastor Jerry Nable. Mukha na po akong Indiano. Huwag niyo na pong hayaang mga amoy pang Indiano sa Pilipinas. Tulungan niyo po ako na maabot ang aming field as soon as. Ano po? Hindi po namin kayo i-Indianin. No? Huwag niyo rin po kaming Indianin. No? I'm going to the city of Gurgaon. It's just a city, but it's 1.8 billion people. No? Just 40 minutes down the north part of New Delhi. So please pray for me and my family. It's creative. We will be going there as students. No? I'm 45 years old, mukha lang 44. So huwag niyo na po akong patagalin dito. I really would like to go. Thank you very much.
Good evening everyone. My name is Kyle Daniel Kwan from Rolinid Baptist Church under the leadership of my pastor, Pastor Robert Kent Gisalva. Lord willing, I will be going with Missionary Mark Maglasang and the family this coming July 2024. The same country, India. And then kindly pray for me, church, as I follow God's direction for my life to immerse myself in foreign missions. God bless you po. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Joy Rabaya, your ambassador to Israel. My sending church is River Spring Baptist Bible Church in Iligan City under Pastor Ruben Sulapas. Church, let's continue to pray for the peace of Jerusalem and the salvation of the Jewish and Gentile people. And pray for me as I go back this coming November. Thank you and good evening.
Amen. Amen. Give a big hand to our missionaries. And a little bit later, after the preaching, we will have them stand here in the front. So you can be able, especially the pastors, to come and greet them, get their cards, and make sure, even for the members as well, that you can be more familiar with them. Then tomorrow morning, we'll have another set of missionaries to give their testimony, and then in the evening as well. Now, Anapa Asia. All right, I'm sorry. One more batch. Those from Asia, please come right now. Asia, please come right now.
Barev Jess, Barilur, Brethren, Im Anun Rachel Ann Clavio, or in English. Hello and good evening, Brethren. My name is Rachel Ann Clavio. I am from Bethany Baptist Church, Makati, under the leadership of Pastor Jerry Noble, and I'm a single lady missionary to Armenia. And I got saved and baptized at an early age and also exposed to different ministries in our church and also attended the Baptist Bible College in Makati. where I graduated AIM, or Associate in Ministry, last May of 2023. I have been learning from a lot of World Missions conferences, and one key takeaway that I got recently is practice what you will be doing in the mission field at in La Loma. So by God's grace, I have been still being involved in our ministry, such as soul winning, discipleship, teaching, because I believe that I should still be doing this and practicing this, because that's what I'm going to do in the mission field in Armenia. Armenia is a Christian country. However, more and more Armenians are turning to atheism. They don't believe in God. So it's my goal, it's my objective that I'll be reaching Armenians, winning souls, discipling them, teaching them the right doctrine, the right Bible doctrine, and eventually have them reach their own countrymen there in Armenia. So also I'll be partnering with Pastor Ed and Amor Pamintuan, for those of you who are also familiar with them. I'll be having my orientation trip, so please pray with me. I'll be leaving on July this year, 2024. So brethren, please pray for me, and also partner with us missionaries as we reach the lost souls in the foreign field, and as we continue to be trained in the mission field, and also with one spirit, with one mind, one faith, one mission. Let's reach more Armenians. My name is RAC, Rachel Ann Clavio, RAC, Reaching Armenians for Christ. Thank you po. Shachnar Halakachun.
Amen. Walay Calvinist sa Armenia. Puro Armenians dito.
Wan chang hao jawe ganagamushu. In English po, good evening churches, good evening pastors. My name is Roslyn Bautista Aquino, and I am your missionary helper to Taiwan. I was sent forth by Community Bible Baptist Church under the leadership of Pastor Jaime Victorino. Got saved and baptized when I was 26 years old at Tans Bible Baptist Church in Taiwan under the leadership of Pastor Dave Green, an American missionary. In 2009, went to the Bible school, graduated in 2014, and in 2015, I've got the privilege to be a pastor's wife for almost 6 years to Pastor Joseph R. Aquino. But sadly, Pastor Joseph took by God and promoted by God in heaven in 2021. But despite of that, I praise and thank the Lord, because He helps me to keep on keeping on, helps me to keep on striving, to keep on pressing on, doing all of His will in my life, especially the soul winning. In 2023, that was last year, God gave me the vision to be a missionary to a foreign nation. Through His word, God spoke to me in Isaiah 49:6. It says there, and He said, "It is a light thing that thou shouldest be my servant to raise the tribes of Jacobs and to restore the preserve of Israel. I will also give thee a light to the Gentiles, that thou mayest be my salvation unto the ends of the earth." So therefore, Lord willing po, this coming September this year, I will be in Taiwan and will start helping Pastor Dave Green there of Tanso Bible Baptist Church, doing the soul winning, winning the lost souls of Taiwanese. So church, come, go with me in Taiwan, but if you can't, don't worry. I will do the going for you. You just pray and support all of us, the missionaries under ABC, because churches, we cannot do it alone. We need God, and we need your partnership as well. Churches, together, we can spread the gospel to every nation. Together, we can win many lost souls all around the globe. Thank you so much, and God bless.
Good evening to everyone. Brother Permar Garcia po, your missionary to Pailin, Cambodia. Ascending Church, Bethany Baptist Church, Makati, under the leadership of Pastor Jerry Nable. Our field is in Cambodia, Pailin. Cambodia before is a killing field, but now it's an open field. And still, the Lord pray more laborers in Cambodia, because in Cambodia, there is still 17 million in population and going rich and poor. Who will go? What the Bible says in John chapter 6, verse 45, 35, "Say not ye, they are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest. Look on the fields, they are white and ready to harvest." We'll be going there to share the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, to testify our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you very much po, the Garcias po, Permara and Anneli, your missionary to Pailin, Cambodia.
So, good evening, churches and pastors. I am Brother Matthew Suponstrim, a Cambodian with my wife, Mary Chin, a Filipina. We are your missionary going back to Cambodia, particularly in the province of Steng Trang, near to the border to Pak Sai Laos. And we are sent out by Bethany Baptist Church Makati under the leadership of Pastor Jerina Ablay. And you know, Cambodia is a small country. We have only 17 million populations, but 95% of them are Buddhists. Only 3% are Christians. That's why we need more laborers there. And that's why for us, when God called us, we was at once obey and answer to the call. And this coming June 25, we will go to the mission field in Cambodia. We already had our tickets, and we would like to express our gratitude to the churches and pastors that partnering with us, praying for us, and supporting us. And because of your faithfulness in doing so, we were able to purchase already a small lot of property in Cambodia in the mission field. And we are praying when we go back, we can start the work and also construct the church building as the Lord continues to provide. So we would like to say thank you once again to the churches and pastors for partnering with us. Thank you, and may God bless you all.
Mayong gabi, Santa Dan, and good evening, brethren, pastors, and churches. First of all, I would just like to say thank you, pastors and brethren, churches, who sending the missionaries, loving missions, and supporting missions. I can just only say one thing tonight, that without missions, we will not be here tonight. And without missions, I will never get to know the Lord Jesus Christ. As a former Buddhist and a grown up in a family of a Buddhism in Cambodia, I personally thank God that Bethany Baptist Church Makati has a missionary with the name of missionary Kit Hamandrun. Went there to Cambodia in 2004 and started the mission there in the place there in Ratanakiri, the farthest province from Phnom Penh, the capital city, around 8 hours. And praise and thank God that I met the missionary and I got saved at the age of 10 in 2010. And by the grace of God, after the years training and going through the process, I praise and thank God that I came here to Bethany in 2018 to pursue my Bible college after my high school, and I surrendered my life at the age of 14 because I realized that after I got saved, my life is not anymore mine, and I should use this life for the sake of the gospel and the sake for the ministry. So I pursued my Bible college in 2018, and I graduated after 6 years. Praise and thank God that I finished 3 courses there in Bethany alone. And the Lord called me to this country of Korea, which is particularly there on the restricted area in the north. It was placed in the heart of my pastor that I was been praying for me. And I don't understand at first, in my first year, when he mentioned that I will be the future missionary to that country. But then after 6 years, confirming with the Lord and through the ministries that I'm particularly praying for, my heart first is that I will be going back to my own country in Cambodia. But then, of course, God's plan is different from our plans. And praise and thank God that after 6 years, I asked my pastor, and he said that he's still praying for me to be the missionary to go to that country. Though I was thinking that maybe the Lord might place other countries in his heart, but then there's none. He's still been praying for me to go to that country for 6 years, and it's still the same. So, brethren, pastors, I am a missionary going to the country of Korea. Initially, we are praying that we can start the work in South, and we are praying for the open doors there on the other side of the country to reach out those Koreans. And of course, brethren, we know the situation and we know the current problems and the restriction in that country. But of course, I believe that the prayers has more power than what we expected. Brethren, please continue to pray, because I believe that is the heart of our Savior. It says in Matthew 24, verse 14, that the whole world should be preached by the gospel so that the end will come. So brethren, continue to pray with me, partner with me, and let us continue to do the work for the sake of the gospel. Thank you so much, and God bless.
Amen. Good evening, everyone. This is your missionary, Nehemiah Kiros, from Cambodia. And I've been to Cambodia for 23 years, assisting my dad, Pastor Wilfredo Kiros. And by God's grace, I surrendered my life last year, and now I am here in front of you. I'm with the batch 2024. And I was sent out from Bethany Baptist Church, Makati, under Pastor Jerry Nable. And thank you very much, Pastor Kent and Dr. Armin Gisalva, for the opportunity. And this Saturday, I'm going back there to continue the ministry. Please help us and pray for us with my family. God bless you. Thank you, Paul.
Good evening, church. Good evening, pastors. I'm Brother Noah Mendoza from Bethany Baptist Church, Makati, under the leadership of our beloved pastor, Pastor Jerry Nable. First, I would like to praise and thank our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, for allowing me to stand before you and share my testimony. I'm not going to a country in Asia, but I'm going to the field of Sydney, Australia. Thank you, Pastor Ken, for allowing me to share my testimony, because we have to leave tomorrow before lunch to catch up with our midweek service together with my pastor. So thank you, Pastor, for the opportunity. I got saved at the age of 10 years old, and the Lord called me to preach at the age of 11 years old. I praise the Lord for His faithfulness in my life through those years, that the same God who enabled me at the age of 11 is also the same God who is with me today. And I'm going to the field of Australia. I surrendered my life way back 2020 during the World Missions Conference of Bethany Baptist Church, Makati, with the theme Vision Beyond Borders. And I break the border of self, of sin, of selfish desires, and gave my life fully to the Lord. I don't know where, I don't know when, but I just told the Lord, Lord, my life is yours. Call me where you want to. And I praise God that I just got graduated in Bible College last year of May, 2023. I graduated in Baptist Bible College in Makati with theology. And I prayed for 1 year for the field that God wants me to go to. So people are asking me, why Australia? Is it because Australia is a first world country? Australia is a well-off country? But I did not even pray for it. I prayed for 5 specific fields. First, I prayed for the Philippines. Our heart's desires that the Philippines might be saved. Second, I prayed for North Korea, the field that missionary Adi will be going. Also, I prayed for Winnipeg, Canada, because our relatives in my father's side is there. So practically speaking, I already have a place to stay at and start a Bible study with. I also prayed for Israel because we have ambassadors there that are praying for me to help them. And also I prayed for Fallbrook, California in the States, because Pastor Jim Christensen, our partner in World Missions, is also praying for me to help him. But I am always reminded of the preaching and the words that our pastor would say, it is not the matter of the need, but it is the matter of God's call. And I praise the Lord that He used Pastor Paul Byers during that conference when he said, we need to see people through the eyes of Christ and through the eyes of compassion. And I opened up to my pastor. I told him about those 5 fields that I am praying, but he told me, Brother Noah, those fields are not the one. But I am praying for you to go to the field of Australia. And I have confirmed that calling through the scriptures. Ezekiel 22:30, the Lord sought for a man that will help missionary Freddy Arellano, our first missionary to Australia. He is suffering with meningitis for 18 years, so he's praying for someone to replace him. But he prayed for 3 to 4 men. He considered them, but those 4 men have different callings. So by God's grace, I'll be that man to go to that field in Australia. I'll be going there next year of April. Please do pray for me. My pastor will accompany me with the visitor's visa, and I'll be processing my visitor's visa here in the Philippines and my religious working visa in Australia so that I can stay there for 2 years. And then I will apply for a temporary visa so I can stay for another 1 year and eventually apply for a permanent residency visa, God willing. So please do pray for me. Don't forget, Ezekiel 22:30. Remember the man, M-A-N, missionary to Australia, Noah Mendoza. Partner with us and support all the missionaries in the Philippines. God bless you and have a good evening.
Touch me with your power.
And when I looked on the light, it was everywhere. The light of the million mornings filled my heart.
Standing, please. If you're saved and born again, say amen. The light of familiar mornings is in our life. Amen. And so it's not for us to keep the light, but to send the light. Everyone standing, please. As we sing this song, send the light. Send the light. Send the gospel light. On the last verse, we will take our offering. So ushers, please prepare. Verse number one, sing.
There's a call comes ringing o'er the restless wind. Send the light. Send the light. There are souls to rescue. There are souls to save. Send the light. Send the light. Send the light. The blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light. The blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore. We have heard the Macedonian call today. Send the light, send the light. And a golden offering at the cross we lay. Send the light, send the light. Send the light, the blessing gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessing gospel light. Shine forevermore. Ushers, please come. Last verse now. Let us not grow weary in the work of love. Send the light. Send the light. Let us gather jewels for a crown above. Send the light. Send the light. Send the light. The blessed gospel light. Let it shine.
That receives without forgetting and gives away without remembering. When you give away something to the Lord, you do not remember it. You just give it away. You make a living by what you get. You make a life by what you give. Every centavo that you give, we have an opportunity for a missionary to win somebody and make that person live from darkness to light for the honor of Jesus Christ. As you give tonight, remember this. God is not asking for anything but a willing heart to make that offering a greater blessing for many people around the world. Brother Frank Denise, Brother Frank, he is my good friend. Please come and lead us in the word of prayer. He is the pastor of the Gospel of Christ Baptist Church in Talamban. And Brad, please lead us in the word of prayer.
Heavenly Father God, we're so thankful, Lord, for the privilege to give now. And Lord, I pray, Lord, that you bless this offering, Lord. We thank you for the privilege to give to support world missions. Lord, we know it's the only investment that lasts forever. Help us not to forget and help us not to get off focus from the Great Commission and starting churches all over the world. Bless the offering now, we pray, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Cast a shadow you cannot overcome, and just when you thought you had it all together, you knew every voice to get you through. But this time the sorrow broke more than just your heart, and reciting all those verses just won't do. When answers aren't enough, there is Jesus. He is more than just the answer to your prayer, and your heart will find a safe and peaceful refuge. When answers aren't enough, He is there. Instead of asking why did it happen, think of where can lead you from here. And as your pain is slowly easing, you can find a greater reason to live your life triumphant through the tears. When answers aren't enough, there is Jesus. Just an answer to your prayer, and your heart will find a safe and peaceful refuge. When answers aren't enough, He is there. When answers aren't enough, there is Jesus. Just an answer to your prayer, and your heart will find a safe and peaceful refuge. When answers aren't enough, when answers aren't enough, when answers aren't enough.
Jesus is the answer, amen? Someone asked me when I gave out the track, Jesus is the answer. Jesus is the answer. Unsa man ni sir? Ingko tan-awa sa ang gospel track, Jesus is the answer. Oh yes sir, unsa man ni? Ang question mo'y pangutan na. Kay na may answer. Lisod kayong na kay answer niya, wakay question. Unsa may question ay sir, kung pananlitan mo abot ang kamatayon ni mo karon. Nakasiguro ka ba mo ato sa langit? Muna'y question, amen? And Jesus is the answer. Well, tonight, we're so thankful for Dr. John Conerup. He was born in Ethiopia. So if you talk about missions, he was born in the mission field. And his parents, Richard and Jeannie, were missionaries there, and then they transferred to Kenya. He is a graduate of the Liberty University in Lynchburg, Virginia. In 1986, he began his internship the Heritage Baptist Church in Georgetown, Texas. Brother John and Pam were approved as BBI missionaries in May 1987 to Kenya. The Conerups served in Kenya until he became the Associate Missions Director for the Baptist Bible Fellowship International in July of 1998. He was appointed Missions Director in May of 2005. His responsibilities include working with nearly 4,000 pastors all over America, and 600 missionaries in 80 countries in the all over the globe, overseeing a staff of 20 at the missions office in Springfield, Missouri. Brother John Conerup is a partner and in missions. And tonight, as he gives the word of God, let's welcome him with a hand of encouragement.
Thank you very much, Pastor Kent. It's great to be in this church again, and the excitement of world missions that is very evident. And it's great to see many pastor friends that I've known for a few years now, and a joy to be here. You heard that I am married to a lady named Pam, and also we have one child, and our daughter's name is Bethany. And so her and her husband, she's 29, her and her husband have surrendered to be missionaries to Cape Town, South Africa. And so it is a joy to my heart to know that my daughter is willing to go. You know, as I preach around the U.S. and around the world, I tell parents, you must let your children go. So now I'm practicing what I'm preaching. Some people say, isn't it going to be hard? Sure. But it's much better that she is in the will of God. And so we heard about that last night, and so it's a joy that my daughter is going to be a missionary. Before I start my message, I want to show a short video for you.
The harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers into his harvest.
The reaping of the gospel harvest is always urgent. The message has always been about Jesus. The motivation is a commission. For every nation a missionary has gone to, every pulpit a pastor has preached from, every individual who has been spoken to, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature has always been the motivation. A charge as relevant today as it was 2,000 years ago when Jesus first spoke those words. In 1950, the founders of the Baptist Bible Fellowship took up this charge.
The basis of the fellowship of the New Testament churches was missionary enterprise. We call ourselves a Baptist Bible Fellowship. Unless we have fellowship in promoting foreign missions, we are not a New Testament fellowship.
Just as our founders saw the urgency of the task, we now must continue to move forward with haste to reach our world in these turbulent times. The purpose of the Baptist Bible Fellowship International has the same urgency and relevance today as it did when we first came into existence. Tell the world about the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Jesus shed his blood for you and for me on that cross. He died on that cross for your sins and for mine. He was buried in the grave, but on the third day he came out of that grave. On the third day he arose. Jesus Christ is alive.
Jesus Christ can make the difference in our world. Jesus Christ can come into a person's life and change that person instantly, immediately, forever. Our message always has been, always is, always will be, all about Jesus.
That's what the world needs to hear. They need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're going to get to assorted verses of the Bible as we go along, but let me start out by telling you of an experience I had a few years ago traveling into a communist nation, and I had the opportunity to speak in a church that was known as an underground church, a secret church. So I had arrived at the hotel, I got prepared, got my Bible, I had it all ready, I was getting ready down in the church lobby to go and preach to this secret church. I didn't know who I was going to meet, but somebody was supposed to come and meet me. So a man came up and said, "Are you Mr. John?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Well, we need to go." And he said, "But just a minute." He went to the desk, got a bag, and put my Bible in the bag. He said, "We cannot let people see this." as we go. So we went outside of the hotel, and we stood there for a few minutes, and he looked around. So I didn't know what he was doing, but I also looked around. I didn't know what I was looking for, but I thought I would do that. And so all of a sudden he says, okay, let's go. So we went, we got in a vehicle, and we drove around the town. And we came to this place, and we got out of the car, and he got out, and he looked around. So guess what I did? I looked around. I don't know what I was looking for, but... So all of a sudden he says, let's go. We walked across the street, down through the alleyways, and up some stairs, and inside of this room were 150 people waiting for me to come and preach to them. Now, what do you preach to those people? Do you preach dedication? Here they are potentially giving up their lives because they are meeting secretly. So I was able to challenge them with the Word of God, and what a blessing it was in my heart. And then I met with the pastor. His name is Joshua. I won't tell you his last name for security reasons, but I asked him to tell me your testimony. How did you get saved? How did you come to being a pastor of a secret church? He said, if you remember, in the 1980s, there was an uprising against our government. The tanks were driving down the streets. He said, I was one of the students that went and stood in front of the tanks. He said, I was not doing it for Christianity or for God. I was just against communism. But because he did that, he was arrested and put in prison. He had been in prison for about 4 months. After 4 months, there was a man that came. He was a prisoner, and he came and began to witness to Joshua. This man had been in prison for 50 years because of his faith in Jesus Christ. But even in prison, he was a witness. And he witnessed to Joshua, and Joshua accepted Jesus Christ as his Savior. So Joshua began to pray and said, God, if you will release me from prison, I will start churches across my country. 2 years later, he was released from prison. And the church that I was in was his fourth church that he had started. Isn't it exciting to know that God is working in places we do not even know? And it's because people are faithful to be a witness where they are, even in prison, willing to serve God. It's amazing to me, Joshua's story, but I'm also amazed at the man who had been in prison for 50 years still serving God. Most of our world today is lost in their sins. They're lost in their sins. They need someone to bring them the truth no matter where they are. The world's population is growing at a very fast rate. And with that growth comes greater responsibility to take the gospel. Over 8 billion people, a huge task. At the same time, there are more opportunities to reach people around the world than ever before. We have so many opportunities around the world. People all over the world are searching for answers concerning peace with some God or someone, something out there. They're looking for ways to have their burdens and their sins lifted and removed. They're looking for answers because of their fear of death. People are searching. We know the answer, don't we? The answer is Jesus Christ. Jesus is the answer to all those things, because when he was put to death on the cross and buried in the grave, all the sins of the world went with him into the grave. And those who accept Christ can have their sins lifted and removed and forgiven. And 3 days later, he rose again. And because he rose again, we can have eternal life. We don't have to be afraid to die because we know Jesus Christ. Therefore, it's imperative that we have more men and women surrender to take the gospel to these people who are searching. Jesus saw the same situation as we see today when he walked on this earth. He spoke about what some people call the harvest prayer. The harvest prayer. Jesus spoke about this three times in the Gospels, and in each time, he was in a different geographical location. We're going to look at those very quickly. First of all, number one, the despised and hated. Those who were despised and hated. The first time is in John chapter 4 and verse 35. The disciples were with Jesus in Samaria, and Jesus said, "Say not ye, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest? Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest." Samaria was a very desolate country, and the disciples, they weren't really interested in those people. In fact, they wanted to postpone the harvest. Don't you need something to eat? Why should we care about these people? Jesus said, the harvest is already, it's ready now. It's ready now. Amen. That was a hard field. A hard field. The people there were despised Samaritans and subject to a lot of hostility from the average Jew. Can you think of people around the world today who are despised and hated by other people? No matter what man might think of other people, God still loves everyone. God still loves everyone. So if we too would lift up our vision, lift up our eyes and beyond the horizon with the eyes of faith, so that the Spirit of God can move through us and our churches and our missionaries around the world, preparing people to praise him from every language and every tribe and every nation. Any way that you think about it, the harvest depends on the supply of laborers. To bring in the harvest, we need laborers. Amen? Number two, the weary and discouraged. The weary and discouraged. The second time we see Jesus talk about this need is found in, he was in Galilee, the area of Israel called Galilee. And it's seen in Matthew chapter 9, verse 35 through 38. And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion on them because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Now, read these verses, the next two verses, out loud with me. Verse 37. Then saith he unto his disciples, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. The Jews in Jerusalem, they had a disdain for the Galileans. They didn't care for them. They didn't really like them. The multitude following Jesus, they were troubled. They were worried. They were downcast, spiritually discouraged. The words describe a condition of weariness because of continual harassment and oppression by others. It was to a point of almost collapsing because of their heavy burden. This phrase conveys the idea of helplessness and dejection. There was no one to guide them and lead them to the right path. No one to provide them with the right direction in life. They were going around aimlessly, pursuing whatever would come along, trying to find peace and happiness, maybe through pleasures or wealth. They had no guiding principles. There are so many false religions in our world today that are confusing people. They're weary, they're searching, they don't know where to find the truth. They are desperately trying to work out good things, do good things to please somebody, to do some kind of ritual, to make some god happy out there. They too were part of the harvest, the Galileans. And Jesus was moved with compassion when he saw them. Can you think about people like that around the world today? Can you think of people who are weary, who are discouraged, who are don't know where to find the truth? There are people like that all around the world. Do you see people who are worried and depressed? Yeah. Number three, the hard to reach. The hard to reach. The third time that Jesus talked about this is found in Luke chapter 10 and verse 2. It says, "Therefore he said unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest." Jesus was in a place called Perea. If you know anything about Perea, it's considered an out-of-the-way place. To go there, you had to go out of the way from wherever you were going. This is where the tribes of Reuben and Gad had inhabited. It was also a desert and a rugged place. Jesus knew the time was short for his crucifixion that was coming, and there were still many villages and people around there that needed to hear his message. Christ saw the harvest of sinners, knowing that their final judgment was soon to come. The masses of our world today are moving toward divine judgment, with only a few laborers to tell them the message. That thought ought to move us like it moved our Savior, Jesus Christ. Can you think of people who are hard to reach? Can you think of people who are out of the way, who are not ready for judgment because they don't know about Jesus? Are there people out of your way that you need to go and tell about Jesus? So then what is the harvest? Those who are hated, those who are hard to reach, those who are distressed, spiritually discouraged, those who are searching aimlessly, those who are in the out-of-way places. The harvest then is the world. Amen. This describes the whole world. The harvest leaves no one out of the picture. God's one mission is to reach them before it's too late. Notice what the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 9. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for who? Every man. Since God desires to have a personal relationship with every man or every person, he sent his son to pay for the sins of every person. Amen. Not just a chosen few. You understand what I'm saying? He sent his son for everyone. Amen. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 2 says, "And he is the propitiation for our sins. And not for our sins only, but also for the sins of the whole world." Jesus didn't die just for our sins, but for the sins of the whole world. That is all humanity. All humanity. Do you know what the word "all" means? I have a good definition for you. Listen very carefully, because this is very deep. Okay, very deep. So listen carefully. All means all. And that's all means. Jesus died for all humanity. No matter how many people are yet to be born in the future, I know Jesus paid the price for them to be saved. After his resurrection, Jesus looked into the eyes of his disciples and said in John chapter 20 and verse 21, "Peace be unto you, as my Father has sent me, even so send I you." Send I you. Where? Send us where? To all humanity. The theme of this conference is one mission. God wants you as a church to stand fast in one spirit, in one mind, striving together for the faith of what? The gospel. Amen. The gospel. God wants all of you to be a part of this one mission. Now, please don't miss this next statement. Don't miss this next statement. I believe that because God is a missionary God who cares about reaching all humanity, we as his people should be missionary people. Amen. That means witnesses for him. Amen. That means going to the regions beyond. If there was ever a man who fully comprehended this biblical concept, it was the Apostle Paul. In reading the New Testament, I believe it's fairly accurate to say that the Apostle Paul had an intense passion to reach people with the gospel of Jesus Christ, to reach the unreached, to those who had never even heard, going places where the gospel had never been. More than any apostle or preacher of the first century, Paul devoted his entire life to taking the gospel to previously unevangelized areas. He was a pioneer missionary, as we would say today. He endeavored with every fiber of his being to go somewhere where they had not heard of Jesus to tell them of the precious gospel. He wanted to fulfill that in his lifetime. It's my belief that the church in every generation has the responsibility to fulfill the Great Commission. Amen. The process of bringing closure to evangelizing the world in Paul's day continues even today. Paul was obsessed with preaching the gospel where the name of Jesus had never been heard. See what Paul says in Romans chapter 15, verse 20. You know this verse. Yea, so I strive to preach the gospel, not where Christ was named, lest I should build upon another man's foundation. The Greek word strived carries the idea of, despite the knowledge that this could be very difficult, that this is a large task, that this will be could be a time of rejection by people, even though it's going to be very hard, I'm going to persist and endeavor to do something for God. Amen. That's what it means to strive. That something is reaching the unreached with the gospel. Paul expressed this obsession, again found in 2 Corinthians 10, verse 16, to preach the gospel in the regions beyond you, and not to boast of another man's line of things made ready to our hand. Notice also in Romans 15, verse 24, that Paul had a great desire to go to Spain. To go to Spain. Why Spain? Why did he want to go to Spain? I guess we probably really don't know exactly why. But there's some commentators who have tried to study this and understand these things, and they say that in those days when Paul was evangelizing, that Spain and Britain were known as the end of the world. And so Paul, I believe, was thinking here, I'm going to go to Spain. I'm going to go to the ends of the world. That's where this church and your church needs to be ready to go, to the ends of the world. If that is true of Paul, then it stresses his great obsession with the Great Commission. He was completely focused on making sure those who had never heard would know about Jesus Christ. It's exciting to see what God's doing with the churches here in the Philippines. It's exciting to see your zeal, your passion, your excitement for the gospel to go out. You are sending people out who have a pioneer spirit to go to places that many people have never heard of the gospel. The Philippine churches, you are now leading the way in world missions. You're leading the way. We are relying upon you. People around the world are waiting to hear. You are the ones to go and tell them. And you are an example to other countries. Amen. You know, when we had the global meeting here in 2011, we brought people from around the world. Why? We wanted them to catch your passion. And now many of them have gone back and they said, we're going to do missions just like they're doing in the Philippines. No forest is too dense like the Amazon jungle in South America. No city is too fortified like the cities in restricted access nations where missionaries sometimes risk it all to take the gospel where they are really not wanted. No desert is too hostile like the coast of Peru, one of the most arid regions in the world. No village is too remote like Arakaka. How many of you know where Arakaka is? That's why it's remote. Most people don't know about it. It's one of the numbers of villages that dot the jungles of Guyana. No hearts are too hardened like the Republic of Ireland, where people are steeped in religion yet are offended by those who come and preach the gospel. No area is too devastated like northern Uganda, where the Acholi people have been ravished by rebel attacks, people fighting against each other in their tribe. HIV and AIDS, malaria, and other diseases have almost destroyed them. No valley is too isolated. No island is too distant. No mountain is too inaccessible. We must go to the extreme limits of our world to declare the message of salvation in Christ to all the world. Today in Kenya, we have around just a little more than 1,000 churches from the efforts of our missionaries and national pastors. This is Makutano Bible Baptist Church that recently built a new building. It's a nice building. Pastor Paul Gichuki has been the pastor of that church for 45 years, led to the Lord by one of our missionaries and trained. That church has started 200 churches out of their church in Kenya, Uganda, and South Sudan. One of them is in an out-of-the-way place called Pokot. Pastor David, pictured here, heard me preach a few years ago about starting churches where there are no churches. He was on the church staff with Pastor Paul Gichuki. He was a man who had only lived in the city. That's all he knew. But he knew that there were no churches in Pokot. So he took his family there. The people walk many miles from several villages to attend that church. Do you know that they are today praying the 938 prayer? Amen. They are also giving to missions. When I was there, they asked me to baptize 20 new believers. If we could go to the next slide. And the next slide. And so I was in the river baptizing 20 new believers. You never know what else is going to be sharing the river with you. Go to the next slide. I'm glad that I was upstream, if you know what I mean. People in other villages are now asking Pastor David, can you please come and tell our village about Jesus Christ? Do we care if these people have never heard about Jesus Christ? I believe that Paul's obsession, which is also God's obsession, which should be our obsession, is to reach all humanity. That is an obsession that creates a passion to go and to give and to pray. First of all, go. We all know our good friend, pastor and evangelist and mission person, Dr. Jack Baskin. Dr. Jack Baskin challenged many people to go. When I was in college, I had my own plans. We had a missions emphasis week, and we had a special speaker, and his name was Dr. Jack Baskin. And he preached that morning, and he said this, If God hasn't called you to America, then you need to go somewhere else. Amen. God spoke to me. Amen. I went forward that day and surrendered my life to be a missionary. In the memory of our good friend, Dr. Jack Baskin, can I say this? If God hasn't called you to the Philippines, then you need to go somewhere else and take the gospel. Go and tell. Pray for more missionaries. Pray 9:38. Pray therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. Praying for more missionaries. When was the last time you prayed that God would send someone from your church? When was the last time, parents, that you prayed and said, God, use my children? I've met a lot of parents who have said, oh, no, not my children. And I said, do you remember when they were born, you came to the front of the church and you dedicated your child to God? And now you're holding them back from God? Oh, don't do that. Don't do that. Pray and give your children. And then last is give. Give to missions. Give to Faith Promise Missions. You can trust God. I always find it interesting that people can trust God to forgive them of their sins, but they can't trust God to give so they can give to missions. Wow. I mean, we do serve a great God, amen? Amen. He created the universe. Surely he can provide for me to give to missions. I've seen God do so many things in helping people give to missions. I've talked to people about their testimonies, and I've heard so many testimonies of how God has supplied. I want to share some of them with you tonight. First of all, God can increase your income. If by faith you say, God, I'm going to give to missions, God can increase your income. I know a lady who she promised to give to missions, and the next day, on Monday, she went to work. The boss called her in, and the boss said, we're going to give you a raise. And it was the exact amount she promised to give to missions. Amen. Do you believe God can do that? Yes, he can. Now, don't expect that to happen when you go to work tomorrow, but it can happen. Amen. Or God can decrease your expenses. He can decrease your expenses. So I've heard so many testimonies that are given by people. Let me share some of them with you. And I've broken them down into four categories, okay? Number one, God uses the unusual and unexpected provision. Unusual and unexpected provision. There was a Bible college student who was in his church, and they had their missions conference. He was so excited about the missions conference, and he promised to give a certain amount for missions that year. The next week, he had lunch with one of the businessmen in the church. They were talking about the mission conference, excited about it. And the Bible college student said, I promise to give this much to missions. And the businessman said, how can you do that? You're a Bible college student. You don't have that much money. Amen, Bible college students. Do we have any? You don't have that much money. How can you do that? He reached in his pocket, pulled out a checkbook and wrote a check for the amount of 1 year of his faith promise giving. An unusual, unexpected provision. I met a lady who said that she was in her home and she had promised to give a certain amount to missions, and one day she got a letter in the mail. She opened it up. She had no idea who this was, and she read the letter, and this is what it said. You don't know or remember who I am, but I recently got saved, and God has convicted me of something. When I was a little boy in your neighborhood, I threw a rock through your window, and I never confessed it. But now that I'm saved, I want to confess it. And here's money to take care of your window, and it was exactly what she promised for Faith Promise Missions. Can God do that? Wow, 15 of you think so. Can God do that?
Amen.
Amen. The second way, budgeted giving. Budgeted giving. This is the way my wife and I give to Faith Promise Missions. And so what we do is we put our tithe first. Amen?
Amen.
The tithe belongs to God. It's given to the church. That's what you do. You put that first in your budget. You put it before anything else. And then second, we put our faith promise missions, what God's laid on our heart. We've prayed and asked God, God, what would you want us to give? And we put that second, and you say, but where does faith come then? Faith comes in trusting God to take care of all our other things that we have in life. And it's amazing how God does that. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you. And so we put that first, the tithe, and then missions, and we have faith trusting God. And every year, it's amazing how my wife and I can increase and increase and increase, and He keeps taking care of everything. Amen. There was a lady who was a nurse. She had a very modest income, and so she had promised to give a small amount to missions, her first year to give to missions. 5 years later, she was talking to some people giving her testimony. And 5 years later, she was giving 10 times what she was giving 5 years previous. And they said, how do you do that? She said, I put God first. I give my tithe, I give missions, and I trust God to take care of the rest. And it seems like every year there's more, so I give more to God. And then there's more, so I give more to God. Budgeted giving. Do you think God can do that?
Yes, sir.
Yes, He can. Number three, strategic methods or creative strategies. Creative strategies. You think, wow, this is kind of different. Well, let me give you some examples. There was a 13-year-old girl. By the way, children and teenagers, they can give to missions. Amen. A 13-year-old girl was challenged to give to missions. And so she said, what am I going to do? How am I going to give that? Her grandmother had taught her how to sew and do some nice ornaments and things. And so she began to make those and sell them to her family and her friends. And everything she made, she gave to her Faith Promise missions. Creative ways of generating income so that you can give to missions. You don't do those things to keep it and hoard and do what you can for yourself. You do those things so that you can give to missions so that people can hear of Jesus Christ. There was an overweight salesman. An overweight salesman. At the end of his missions conference, he decided, I'm going to give this much money this year. And so he promised it, put it on his card, turned it in. On the way home, he's driving home, he said, I don't know. I don't know how I'm going to give that kind of money. What can I do? And then he began to think about his weight. So he said, okay, I'm going to skip lunch every day. And what I would have paid for lunch, I'm going to give to missions. At the end of 1 year, he gave more than he had promised, and he lost 50 pounds. So I call it the Faith Promise Mission Diet. You know, there's a lot of diets around the world. You can try Faith Promise Missions Diet. And then number four. Sacrificial giving. Wow. I tell the people in America, I wonder how many Americans are really giving sacrificially. I know there are some. But we are in abundance. Sometimes we give even our leftovers. Sacrificial giving. Giving up something that you might want and you give it to missions. Putting something away that you don't need so that someone can hear about Jesus Christ. Here's a good statement for you. Live simply that others might simply live. Live simply that others might simply live because they hear about Jesus Christ. So all these ways, and I'm sure there are stories about you in one of these ways of giving to missions. I believe Jesus was very clear with what he said in Matthew chapter 6, verse 21. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Someone said this, what we do with our money doesn't simply indicate where our heart is. According to Jesus, it determines where our heart goes. If I want my heart in a particular place, and not in another place, then I should put my money in that place and my heart will be there. That's just the way it is as humans. I've heard people say, I want to have more of a heart for missions. And I always respond, well, that's good. Jesus tells us exactly what to do to have a heart for missions. Put your money in missions and your heart will follow. Amen. You want a heart for missions? Amen. Give to missions. Amen. You want to see people get saved around the world? Amen. Give to missions. Amen. We must learn to use our money to show that God and not things or possessions are our treasure. When we treasure God more than anything else in life, fulfilling the Great Commission will be on the top of the priority in our lives. Amen. If we, like the Apostle Paul, become obsessed with reaching the unreached, we will make big decisions that will involve sacrificing in order that others can hear about Jesus Christ. Why do we need to hear? Why do they need to hear the gospel? Why do they need to hear the gospel? Because everywhere in the world that I go, I find people are doing things, searching to find the answers. For example, years ago, I was in Cambodia, Phnom Penh, and I saw many of these men selling these birds on the side. And I asked the missionary, what are these birds? What are they for? Are they pets? You buy the bird and you keep it in a cage in your home? He said, no, these are something religious to the people. I said, tell me the story. He said, these men go out to the forest. They catch these birds. They take them to the Buddhist temple. The monks pray over these birds. Then they go and sell these birds. And they tell the people when they buy it, they are to pray and confess their sins and then let it fly away, and their sins will fly away with the bird. Can I tell you, what they are searching for can only be found in Jesus Christ. He's the answer. You can go to Thailand and there's a large temple. Thousands of people go into this temple every day. Inside this temple are 9 pink coffins. And they line up. And when it's your turn, you go to the monk and you pay him some money. You know, that's usually what the reason is. You pay the money, and then you're told, get inside the coffin and lay down, and the monk chants a prayer over you. And then they tell you, now you get out, and you're a new creature. All your sins are gone, and they're dead in the casket. What they're searching for can only be found in who? Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. People are trying to work their way into heaven. They're trying many religious rituals to please some god or something. So we must tell them the truth. The truth is Jesus Christ. All the world's religions, they teach you that to satisfy God, you must do this and you must do that and you must do this and you must do that. And maybe one day, perhaps, you'll please somebody. But the Bible teaches that Jesus did everything. You don't have to do anything. It's already done. It was done on the cross. And he rose again. And Jesus is the answer. All around the world, we see people in desperation trying to find peace with God, even from their ancestors. Many people are kissing shrines to find favor with an idol, cremating their dead families, putting them on the fire, on the wood, lighting them on fire, hoping that their ashes, as they are pushed off into the river, that somehow, some way, they will find enlightenment. Priests that help people, they're mainly only interested in being paid money. People going to their temples and spinning prayer wheels, trying to help their ancestors who have died, or trying to get guidance from their ancestors, praying for help. These all represent people searching for help, and they need the truth of Jesus Christ. And our God has designed the church, your church, to take the truth to the world. Your church is engaged in the biggest, the most important endeavor ever, and that's world missions, the Great Commission. We are facing the strongest enemy. Satan is working hard to deceive people. But the Bible says, greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. And then we still have the greatest message and the greatest power to proclaim it. Jesus said, all power is given unto me. Go ye therefore. Take the gospel. Many years ago, I was in a mission conference in Africa. They were beginning to send their first missionary out to another country. So they were ready to send them on their way. The missionary stood down in front and they said, come give your offerings to help this missionary and his family go. People came and they brought fruit and laid it at the altar. That's all they had. They would sell that and give the money. Some people brought vegetables to the front. There were a few people that brought a few chickens and tied them to the front. This was their offering to help. There were a few that even brought goats and tied them in the front of the auditorium. And then there was a lady that came down the aisle. She turned around, put her hands in the air and said, God, I don't have anything to give but myself. That's really what God wants. What does it say in 2 Corinthians chapter 8? First, they gave of themselves. When you give yourself, your whole heart, your whole mind, your whole strength, everything, all the rest will come in. So give yourself. What about you tonight? Are you ready to give yourself? Like Paul? Are you obsessed with reaching the unreached with the gospel? What about you? Will you be a witness where you are? Will you give to missions? Will you go to the unreached? Who's going to step out this week and say, I will go? Oh God, help us reach our world with the gospel, not for our sake, but for the sake of God. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Our Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's all about Jesus. The world is searching. There are so many struggling. They need to hear the answer. We have it. And God, help us to go around the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
While your heads are bowed and eyes are closed, tonight, I believe we need to be intentional about our efforts in world evangelism. We need to be intentional in how that we give to missions. And the word tonight that always rings in my mind is obsessed. Obsessed. Are we obsessed like Jesus was obsessed? Are we really intentional about world evangelism? Because there is no other mission. Wa na may lain, unsa pa atong gipangita? Wa na lain. Maura gyud ni. It does not matter what conference you go to, trying to look for something else. There is no other mission, folks. There's only one mission. And that is to preach the gospel to all the world. Tonight, I believe we as pastors and leaders should lead the way. The piano plays softly tonight. If you're a pastor, you're a leader. Stand from your seat. Come to the altar right now. You can come up here in the stage. You can come up here, brother. Para dili mag-huot diha. Plus, please come up here. Please come up here. Let us be intentional. If we really believe that Jesus is coming soon, we need to go back to our churches, teach what we have learned this week, teach what we have already learned, teach what we have already practiced, maybe practice what we have not been practicing anymore. Because I believe if we just do what we need to do tonight, from what we have heard thus far, let this conference be a henceforth conference for each and every one of us. Meaning from now on, if you're a leader, if you're a pastor, if you're an influencer in your church, maybe you're a Sunday school teacher, maybe you're a ministry leader, come and ask the Lord, Lord, I want to be intentional. I just don't want to ride the wave. Pasakay-sakay lang. I want to be intentional about what God wants me to do. You may be in the youth department, in the professional department, with the men's ministry, with the ladies' ministry. Ladies, please join these that are already kneeling before the Lord tonight. Stand from your seat. Come to the altar. Church workers, you can stand. Come to the altar. Stand from your seat. Come to the altar. And join these that are kneeling right now. Be intentional. Are there things in our life that are now more treasured than what is needed to be treasured? For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Wapat nakapasar sa exam, surrendered kita sa Ginoo. Karon nakapasar na ta sa board exam. Murag nagduha-duha na ta sa unsay gusto ipabuhat sa Dios sa atong kinabuhi. Sa wapatay trabaho, mainiton kay ta sa Dios, karon nakatrabaho ta. Nawala man. What happened? Wa pay negosyo, faithful kaayo. Karon nakanegosyo, na blessed lang, nakalimot na ta. Folks, the devil is tricky. The devil is a liar. You don't want to believe his lies because he is out to get you. He is out to make you miserable. Just continue to pray. Just continue to pray. If God is calling you to the field right now, you may not know where it may be, but you know that God has not called you to the Philippines. So you should go somewhere else. Go somewhere else where you can preach the gospel. Pastor Gisava will pray a prayer of dedication for all of us that are here tonight.
Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I want to thank you for the message that we have heard. We thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit. I am sure that the Holy Spirit of God is telling these men and women that they have a place in the mission field, whether it is giving, whether it is sending, whether it's encouraging someone to go or they themselves going to proclaim no other name but the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh God, how grateful we are that you have chosen us to become a part of this ministry, to be a part of being involved in sending missionaries around the world. And Lord, I thank you that you have allowed us to be involved in preaching the gospel here in Cebu City. And I pray that you will strengthen us as ever before. And may all together with these men and women here at the altar kneeling, I pray that you will touch their heart and make their decision completely for the purpose of dedicating themselves unto you. We thank you for love and we thank you for your purposes and plans for us. And I ask that you will get glory and honor in this time of invitation. Thank you for Dr. Conderup. Thank you for the friendship that we have and for the job that he is doing in the missions office to encourage missionaries and pastors around the world to continue serving and giving their lives for Jesus Christ. Help us that we will forget our welfare. We will forget our own interest, but our interest will only be to preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. We ask that you will continue to work in our hearts, grip our hearts to make our decisions permanent, that never change for your honor. In Jesus' name I pray, amen, amen.
And all the people said, amen and amen. Praise the Lord. What a great message, amen. Wow, last night, this morning, tonight,
Mga kaigsunan, napay usa kaadlaw. Napay usa kaadlaw. Nag-notes mo. Itudlo nato ni sa atong mga tao. Itudlo nato ni nindot kayo mga kaigsunan. Dili ta ma-discourage. Hapit na gyud ang pagbalik sa atong Ginoo. That is why I believe God is calling. Have you noticed God has called so many? Last year, Dr. Byers, 50 plus, right? Last year, 40 plus. 40 were called last year. This year, 25. Sa una, pila lang to. Na ay mga napulo, 15. Karon nagdubli, nagtripli. You know why God is calling? Because it's the last day. It's the last hour. It's the last minute. And I believe we need to do more. And we're gonna not only encourage our pastors through conferences, we encourage our young people through our camps as well. Now, some of you have been asking me about the Youth Congress. Now, please bear with us. Our Youth Congress dates have been changed because of the change in the schedules. We were preempting the change of schedules that of the school year that was announced on the newspaper. So we wanted to make sure that our Congress date would fall on a vacation month or a vacation week. So it's going to be on June 17 to 20 will be our Youth Congress. And the theme will be Anchored in Faith, Steadfast in Purpose. And our Congress fee will be 850 pesos. Tungod ni sa inflation, pero mga kaigsunan, nagkinahanlan sa taniini. Pero kabantay sad mo sa ato mga young people, no? Ato mga young people, kung maghisgot ta og mga camp, magpalibre. Pero kung Shopee, kung GrabFood, kung ano, wala, gasto kayo eh. Grabe kayo. Kigayo. Dili na masakay og jeep. Grab taxi na. Taxi na. Di awa mtay Uber diri no. Bro, kuana ka ng angkas. Ano na ba? So, kanang, that will be June 17 to 20. And pastors, we want to keep the momentum going. Okay? Natay one mission, one faith, one mind, one spirit. Padayuno nato ni. And we will continue to encourage our young people. And we are praying that many of our young people will also surrender to the Lord. Have you noticed our testimony givers tonight? They were saved at an age of 10 years old, 8 years old. Bata pa ba? You can never discount the fact that God uses everybody. Tomorrow we will hear a testimony of one that God has called to a unique place. And basta, dili lang batanon hasta tiguang gitawag sa Ginoo. Di man ipinaakay ang paministre. Brad, surrender ka sa Ginoo, wala man kay ngipon. On siya man na ining ministry pinaakay. Ha? All right. Before we go, I'd like to ask our missionaries that presented tonight to line up here in front. So you will have an opportunity. Every Sunday, our gym is always full of cars. Our members' cars go all the way up to the corner. That's a blessing. Mona Church, Paminaw, Bible Baptist Church, Katibunan, those of you that are on site, those of you are online, this coming Sunday will be our annual commitment Sunday for the Faith Promise Missions Giving. So you have heard the challenge tonight. Guapo kay ni, aong gisuhat niyo. Unexpected giving. You make that commitment, there will be unexpected giving na ay provision sa Ginoo. Budgeted giving. Kani, mao ni amo, budgeted. Whatever we commit, amo na nang ihatag. Morabag, one day millionaire, 29 days sustainer. Ana ni siya amo. Inigdawat sa allowance, hatag dayon sa tithes, hatag dayon sa faith. Muabot mangyud og 31 ang budget. Amen. Pasalamat, Pastor Ribaton told this morning with testimony
dawat sa allowance, balhin lang og envelope. From allowance envelope to offering envelope. Mausad na yung nakita na ako ni Pastor Gisalva. So, ato lang ning gipadayon. Then, strategic giving. You can be able to do extra things, other things, to be able to add more to your income so that you can be able to supply and to make good on your commitment. And of course, one of the best ways is sacrificial giving. Amen? So, what was the term you said about the diet? Faith, promise, missions, diet? The faith, promise, missions, diet. Oh, dagana ni. Kung gusto mo mag-diet, pwede ni. Pwede ni. Guwapo ni. Alright? All Bible College students to proceed to the stage after the service. Alright? Tanan Bible College students, Brother Chaddy would like to practice. And then, tomorrow afternoon, 1:30, ang alumni sa Bible Baptist College will meet for a short program. 1:30. Ugma sa hapon. Tanan alumni sa Bible Baptist College. Alright, I hope that I have done all these announcements. Those that will be having dinner tonight at the Mercy Function Room, Missionary Balabag, Missionary Cotamora, Missionary Abaliera, Missionary Aquino, Missionary Katakutan, Missionary Fermar Garcia, Missionary Del Mar, Missionary Mondihar, Missionary Obanya, Missionary Procopia, Missionary Deliosa, Missionary Arizabal, puro mini missionary, no? Missionary Mahoney, Missionary Guinyares, Missionary Joseph, Pastor and Mrs. Joseph Abelyar, Pastor Mrs. Dulay, Pastor and Mrs. Arañas, Pastor Johnny Argabio, Pastor Mrs. Joy Bilotindos, Pastor Mrs. Rene Barantes, Pastor Mrs. Jeho and Julius Canoy, Pastor and Mrs. Samuel Domingo, Pastor and Mrs. Ridolfo Itumay ni, dili ni Itubay, Pastor and Mrs. Ray Langsangon, Pastor and Mrs. Nimrod Laurejas, Pastor and Mrs. Esmenyo Magbalita. Kinsa man yung Esmenyo Magbalita? Naba si Esmenyo Magbalita dire? Naadi ay present. Amen. And Pastor and Mrs. Magbalita, Pastor June, and then Pastor and Mrs. Claro Manulat, Pastor Mrs. Kaliplip, Pastor Mrs. Baybayon, Pastor Mrs. Del Rosario Manny, Pastor Mrs. Leopoldo Espinosa, Pastor and Mrs. Brother and Sister Engineer Edgar Sibunga. Amen. Pastor na nun akong nasulti, Brad. Pastor, ana ba? Oh, Pastor magigabad kay Extension Pastor. Oh, okay, Pastor and Mrs. Ryan Buscato. All right, so let's all stand up, please. Let's sing the song, I'll Say Yes, Lord, Yes. I don't know who owns this, but if you have misplaced your Bible and say ito. Okay, Nana. Answered prayer. Okay. Inigkanta sa word yes, atong i-emphasize. Yes, ana ha? Sing!
I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I agree. And my answer will be yes, Lord.
All the ladies, yes. Sing this. I'll sing. Ladies. All the men,
when your spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart
together,
and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes.
All right, this side first, and then this side. Please come and shake the hands of our missionaries that presented tonight. This side first, please go very quickly para mapaspasta. And then you are dismissed. Dito lang exit nato, okay? God bless you. Maayong gabi kanatong tanan. O, paspas, ayon nagdagang istorya, ha? Lamano lang and say, I'm praying for you. God bless you. Ano ba? Lamano. Dali. O, dali. Dali. Diri na side. O. Okay, murag wa mo tindog ang diri nga side. Murag nag mag-surrender siguro ni pagka-missionary ni. Diri na sad.
Yeah, diri dayon, diri. Diri dayon, diri. Okay.
Hello. Kaya Coral, picture ta diri sa stage. Dali, dayon. Kaya
Coral. The Bible College. Missions Country Night tomorrow, members. Come in your best attire. Best missions attire. Tomorrow night. Missions Country Night. Come in your best missions attire. Bawal ang G-string.